Na 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 na, na 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 na, na na na, gonna take my time. Na 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 na, na 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 na, na na na, gonna take my time.
Autocrafters, your source for Falcon, Fairlane, Full Size, Mustang, Maverick, Pinto, Ford Truck, Cougar. Contact us at www.autocrafters.com.
So what are we talking about this week? Well, we're still on the floor pan because we had literally two people right in the comments. It was more than that, but, you know. Two people right in the comments below that said they wanted to see things about the weld out on the floor pan. So that's what we're going to do is we're going to give a few tips and tricks on welding a floor pan into your car. Not even necessarily a Ranchero. This stuff will fly for just about anything. And away we go. Do us a favor, leave a comment in the section below. We want to know what you think. And also, like and subscribe. All of that stuff helps grow this channel exponentially. We can't do this without you. 100,000 subscribers, we're looking for them by Christmas. One of the things I wanted to go over with this is not necessarily every jot and tittle on the welding, but go over some tips and tricks on things that I've come across while I've been starting the weld out on this. You've seen that I've already been working on it. Number one, always check your equipment first. Now, one thing I ran into on this particular weld out was that while I was doing this, I was in such a hurry to get started on it, and that's always your first mistake, is to get in a hurry doing anything on these old cars. I forgot to turn the argon on with my welder, and thus, these welds right here were done without argon, and so they're kind of crappy and porous, and I don't even know if I'll be able to keep them, but I did discover that before I went too much further with it. You need to make sure everything's ready to go before you start welding. That's an important point on this. Make sure nobody's jacked around with your settings on your welder, that it's exactly where you need it to be. As Robert has said in the video that I did, which is in a link below me here and in the description below, always test weld before you go in and start doing anything. Now, in a case where you're doing floor pans, you're going into some fairly thick metal in most places. The cross members, the frame horns, any of that kind of stuff on these cars like these, that is a thicker gauge steel, and you're going to be fine going at a hotter setting to weld that in. Matter of fact, I think you probably should go at a little hotter setting, but you want to weld something of that same thickness with sheet metal on top of it just to make sure that you're not going to be blowing everything out whenever you're doing your work. Point number two is, yes, you will have to take a hammer and hammer things whenever you are welding on your car. And that is because Ford actually did the same thing back in the day. There were a lot of times that they would hammer the floor sections or whatever that weren't quite perfect so that they could get the two pieces to mate together. It wasn't always done, but I have seen evidence of it having been done on classic cars. There's a 72 Mach 1 that I know of that was an unrestored car, and the firewall and the inner fender apron were literally hammered together so that they could weld them in. Stuff like that did happen on the assembly line because, you know, these things were being put together by manly men smoking Marlboros and drinking coffee all day long. So things like that would happen. Now, another thing that I like to do is I will go in on these kind of floor pans. And again, this is not just a whole floor pan. This is when I'm doing half pans and things like that. I've done this on the truck before. If I'm having a problem with the panels mating up like I want them to, I'll take a block of wood, go on the underside with a jack, and jack the lower panel up to meet the top panel if I can't get the top panel to drop into the position that I need it to be in. And sometimes that does happen. Your panel may be a little bit short, say by a half an inch or less, and this will allow you to put those two together so you can get that good solid sandwich between the two pieces of sheet metal so that there is a tension fit, if you will, between the two sheet metals and not it's sitting up in the air a half an inch and you're bridging a gap with weld. Not a good solution. Now, another one that a guy wrote in and said is, you know, how are you going to go in and stitch the panel in? I'll tell you this. After you set the pan in place, if it's tight on both sides, you put in the straps like we've got here, and you start your welding, it isn't going to go, quote unquote, anywhere when you start welding. And when you do this combined with the sheet metal screws that hold things into position, you're not going to go anywhere, and you can pretty much just pick your point and start welding. Now, one thing I will say that I will do is I will go in and weld like I did back here on the back torque boxes on the car, and then I will also move up from there and probably weld in at the very toe section of the car on both sides. I'll hit one side and then go to the other back side or even the other front side. It really doesn't make any difference. I'm just spot welding. So it's going to be hot in one place for a second. If I'm only doing one or two, say on the top of the torque box back here and then down here in the toe section of the torque box, and then I'm going to move up to the toe boards in the front of the car and weld the toe boards in a couple of spots, then move back to the other torque box in the rear and then come up to the front section up here, and then I start moving into the center. You have to remember, you have the tunnel section on a full floor pan, then you have the cross member section for the transmission, and then you have the tunnel section at the very back, and you have the side plates, which should be tight to the floor pan. So with all of that being said, if this pan starts to walk, you're welding far too much in an area, like you're doing stitches or something. On the idea of using the self-tappers, a guy asked me what he should do about the little hole in the middle of the hole that you're putting in for your spot weld. I'll go in with my MIG wire and I will try to hit that hole, the smallest one first, fill that, and then rosette out around that weld and basically fill it either on both sides. Like I'll go in and put a C-shape on one side and then a C-shape on the other side to fill the rest of that in. It does not always work out that way, because what I find happens to me a lot of times is the wire, when I strike it, I lose vision of it for just a second, and it'll automatically go to the sheet metal point on the larger hole. I've still had pretty good success with it filling in that small hole, and even if it's there on the underside, if you're doing a dead nuts restoration, you can go in and tack that on the bottom and just fill it up with weld and then grind it smooth, and nobody's ever gonna know that you've been in there if you do it right. One of the cool things about doing this kind of work too with the spot welding is, if you're welding up inside the car where the pan is at, there's gonna be a little spot. If you do a hole system like we've done in here on all of these, you're gonna have a place where it sucks the metal up a little bit from where the weld hits it on the bottom. And what that'll do is it'll give you the effect of a spot weld. I'm not sure what the head on the spot welders that they used looked like, but I have to believe they were pretty darn big. And these spot welders were pretty high amperage when they were putting these cars together because of the size of the spot welds. This isn't really a tip so much as something I discovered when I was doing this. I went through and cleaned out all of the holes. There was no POR15 anywhere inside of any of the holes. But in some places, I'd left the E-coat right up to the edge of the hole and just made sure I went in and blew out the hole itself with an air gun and then welded into the hole, and I found that it really didn't make that big a difference whether or not I had cleaned the outside perimeter. Now, I know that there's a lot of you guys that weld on a regular, and you're going to tell me that I'm contaminating my weld, possibly, but I don't know if that's a problem in a case like this, because the area inside that we're really concerned about on our weld is very clean from the grind out with the tool that Robert showed us how to make. So I kind of go back and forth on whether or not that's that big a deal. Whether you should take away all that E-coat, I don't know. I am going to go in after we get done a POR15, the entire floor in this thing, from the sills all the way down into the center of the floor pan, so that Logan's got a good clean setup. Another tip is to look out for fire. And especially on a car like this Ranchero that has these open areas in here, sparks can fly if you've got trash like leaves or pine needles or anything down inside of these places. You can end up starting a fire in the car and possibly your whole garage. Seam sealer is probably your biggest issue, because down inside these areas where you're going to be welding, there will be dripped seam sealer from where they put them together, because I'm pretty sure what they originally did is they laid down some seam sealer and then they spot welded the pieces together to make sure everything was nice and watertight-ish. So that's a tip for you. Watch out for fire. So those are the takeaways from my welding experience thus far, and I am not done yet. I still have to go in and weld the side plate on the other side, and then Logan is going to finish weld the rest of these, and he's going to clean up our turd welds that we did on the tow board so we can get this thing buttoned up and out the door for the time being. We're going to be jumping off of this for a little while. We've got a 64 Falcon hardtop that we're going to be doing a couple things on, as well as we're going to be doing some stuff on our 63 Galaxy 500. So come back around, folks. There's going to be more going on than you can just shake a stick at. And with that happy note, we'll see you on down the road. Well, grab the welder. Time to weld some more stuff.
Hey, Bo.
Yeah, hey, Bo. Gonna be welding now. Boy, gonna go blind. You know that stuff they told you about when you was a kid? They told you to make you go blind? Ain't that at all. He's to welding. We ought to make you blind. Won't be able to see no more. Can't race. Can't race. Yeah. Gotta race the cars. Yeah. Big slips.